So artificial intelligence obviously is going to change our world in so many different ways, including natural history and conservation. So I'm here at Shenandoah National Park in the States, and it's an area I'm not very familiar with. So we've been using identification apps. We've been using Merlin, we've been using iNaturalist, my colleagues have been using Seek. Phenomenal what they can do, how they can just identify things from photos or song. I'm here with Anil Madhavapeddy, Professor of Planetary Computing at the University of Cambridge. We meet a lot in offices and discuss, so it's nice to be in the real world.
Yes, the fresh air.
Yeah, so how do these astonishing models work?
So the idea behind AI is that you can have learning algorithms. So when you normally write a computer program, you write some code and it does what you coded it to do. Mm-hmm. And it rarely changes or deviates from that specification. But with learning algorithms, you do the opposite. You build something called a neural network. And this neural network is just a series of very, very simple weights and structures, a bit like the neurons in your brain. Mm-hmm. And initially, they don't know anything. They're just arranged in a series of small layers. And then what we do is we give it data. And we say that given some data, we can adjust the neurons so that it learns patterns within that data. And you can also associate it with labels. So you can say that, for example, if we look in this part of the world, that we can see some ferns, we can see some trees, mm-hmm. we can see mm-hmm. some sun, mm-hmm. And we help the network to identify what it's looking at. Mm-hmm. And then it turns out that if you do this billions and billions of times, then the shape of the neurons form what's called a model, which can be used to do all kinds of inferences about things which you haven't even anticipated. So by giving it enough data that it can start to recognize what a bird is or what a fern is, it can then distinguish between different types of those and also recognize things of similar shapes as well. It can start to make connections beyond the data that you give it in the first place.
Astonishing. So we have this wonderful collaboration. So we're interested in evidence synthesis, a website, Conservation Evidence, to pull together the global literature. I read 1.3 million papers in 17 languages and pull that together. Yeah. But we're now using AI with you and your colleagues. So that's the same sort of approach, I guess.
It's the same approach. So whenever you have these AI models, you have different types of models because it depends on what kind of data you give it. Mm-hmm. So the simplest ones are known as language models. And I'm sure you've used chatbots before, mm-hmm. for example. Mm-hmm. And with these, what's happened is that we've taken almost all of the data on the internet and we've taken trillions and trillions of words. And we've trained these things known as foundation models, pre-trained models, which generally know what the general shape of language is. Mm-hmm. And this is done across multiple languages, across different types of data, mm-hmm. Different kind of forms of the written word. And then we can fine-tune them so that they can understand specific types of data. And the thing about these pre-trained models is that they can take in vast amounts of written content, and they can help you categorize it much, much more quickly. But of course, the problem, though, is that you don't know how to validate these results. Mm-hmm. So you can't just give something to an AI and say, please classify all of these evidence documents without knowing whether or not the results of the classification are any good. Mm-hmm. Now, with Conservation Evidence, with the work your team has done, over the last 15 or 20 years, you've assembled a manual corpus of what evidence-based literature is, what the experiments were, and humans have looked at these and actually labeled them step by step and actually validated that they're correct. Mm-hmm. So the only thing we did was to take this data and use it as additional training for these pre-trained models to say that, well, can you help us just find some more documents that have the same kind of form? Mm-hmm. And so where a human team would look at perhaps a few thousand documents doing a systematic review, we can now expand the search to all of the world's literature. We can look at hundreds of millions of documents. Because once we have that seed, that training seed of what an expert reviewer is doing and what their methodology is, these learning algorithms can kind of figure things out for themselves. But you still can't get rid of the human. Mm-hmm. So all we're doing is augmenting the human capability here mm-hmm. by a bit like, you know, if they're using Google search to look for papers, we can now give them this AI-powered search that is finding similar papers across the literature and letting them judge whether or not it's what they want to see or if it's in scope for the review they're doing. And one of the really cool things is that because these things can connect together, we can take different inclusion criteria from different systematic reviews and try to connect the dots with the evidence as well. And so this means that we can not only let one team accelerate forward, we can also let this work across multiple teams mm-hmm. and help them find commonalities across the work that they've been doing. Yeah. So it's not just doing that initial kind of first search. It's changing the way that evidence synthesis and the global community can kind of work together.
And it's astonishing how well it works. So we redid our Lepidoptera synopsis, and it found 97% of the papers and some more. You know, it is mind-boggling how well it works.
It is. The only thing I couldn't do is learn how to pronounce Lepidoptera. But I know how to write it, and I know how to make it work with the AI. It's remarkable. The recall of this versus the results from the human team were comparable. But we found many, many thousands more potential papers as well. Mm-hmm. So, and now we also build the labeling infrastructure through our website, so the team can go through these extra candidate results and kind of figure out exactly what they want to include in the next kind of iteration of their criteria as well.
And it's breathtaking, exciting, it's fabulous. So what's the future of AI? What's going to happen next? What are the new ideas?
Well, we're only looking at literature right now. But if you think about the world, we have two ways of learning about the world. First of all, we can look around, we can observe things, and we can see what's going on. So these models are the vision and, for example, if you use Seek or iNaturalist, you can kind of identify plants really quickly these days just by using vision models. You can also use BirdNet to understand birdsong. And this is an audio model. And you can use language models to understand how to interpret the written form. Now, the next frontier is putting all of these together. So understanding what are known as multimodal models, where you can not only give the model a training on one specific sense, you can also combine and cross-train what it sees across those. So consider, for example, if you have a paper with a picture in it, and then that picture would help the model interpret the fact that it was a particular species, and it can then pull in from its knowledge of the literature to say that, well, the range of this species might be this given area, and it can help use all of that context to help inform kind of what's going into the evidence review. Now, it would not inform the experts about this, but it would give that as contextual possible information, and then they would then decide and validate that those results and put them all together. But essentially, we can combine the sum of human observations, the sum of human knowledge, and put them together into these really quite insightful models that can spot connections across seemingly disconnected data, and then let humans decide whether or not that's a hypothesis worth exploring further.
So we haven't talked about the problems, and we worked together on a paper identifying the problems, and there are indisputably problems with AI, but let's not discuss them now, just acknowledge that they exist. Yeah. But it is phenomenally breathtakingly exciting what's happening at the moment and what the potentials are for just making the assessment of knowledge, the assessment of biodiversity, the options just so much more efficient and effective.
Yeah. And especially as a computer scientist, we have the opportunity to contribute towards conservation as well. So we've used technology for lots of human good, but also it's incredibly exciting that we can use this to help conserve nature and hopefully preserve the natural world and contribute towards all of the hard work that you and your colleagues have been doing over the last few decades.
And it's been a huge amount of fun.
It has been great fun, because Shenandoah National Park is the greatest park I've been to in ages.